in certain areas. We also have a different group of, you saw how big that list was of who the producers are, or the operators, or the drillers. Different drilling companies have leases in different areas, and sometimes they'll put an area on a back burner for time specific till they can get back to it, and this may be the case right here, and I'm sorry to say that.
Thank you. Any questions? I think I can pass this mic around. Should be too much of a problem.
Okay, I would like to address my question to Sean, because Becky, with all due respect, you're a spokesperson for the oil and gas industry. And I found quite a few holes in your story, and it was, I'll give you one as an example. The EPA just came out with a story recently, June 4th, 2015, fracking does contaminate water. What goes down must come up. You alluded to the fact that we're just sending water down those pipes when there's 70 plus proprietary cancer-causing chemicals in that water, and you go through the water tables to get to the shale oil. And that I have a problem with, because it's a known fact that it does contaminate water tables, and the EPA just came out with a new study. So Sean, my question to you is, what is, or what can Senator Zaffarini do to try to help protect our water? I have no problem with oil and gas exploration. I have a problem with protecting our environment.
Sure. Well, I mean, we're not scientists either, so we do the same study on the information that you're doing. And we work closely with our higher education institutions, with the Railroad Commission, with DCEQ. We try to make sure we put pressure on them, basically, to do their due diligence, to take a look at these issues, and to make a serious, thoughtful research into it to figure out what's going on. I think that there's a lot of information on both sides, and it's very difficult at this sort of earliest stage in the whole scheme of things to have a conclusive answer either way. So we continue to monitor it. We continue to work with the agencies, and like I said, IRED is heavily involved in this, all their researchers and all their kind of knowledge base going towards it. And if something was to be conclusive, that there was a problem, we would work swiftly, we would pressure the Railroad Commission. They have the ability to shut down wells should a problem happen. But right now we haven't experienced, and I hate to say, well, let's wait till something bad happens, but right now we don't have enough to put a damper on the activity, but we continue to watch what happens and to try to make sure that the industry, with the Railroad Commission, make sure the industry is using the best possible technology, the best possible safety measures and precautions, and just keep following.
As a follow-up, they have also changed the regulations at the Railroad Commission for what can go in frack water. And when I talk about not damaging your water, we're talking about the drinking water, the water table where you get your municipal water and your private wells. That's not damaged because there is pipe and casing between the formation and your water table, so that anything that goes down that tube isn't going to get into your drinking water. And when it comes out, they take out the fluid, and it is now being recycled and used again. So I hope that helps with your...
The pipes crack, they fail.
That's never been proven to happen.
Any other questions? Have plenty of time.
Right there,
what we're using now. And so those chemicals, we can't necessarily pull that water out, and it may actually be a saltwater brine that we can't actually get all the salt out that will react chemically with the other chemicals we're using to frack with. So once we've injected, and injection wells are different than fracking itself. Injection wells are a situation where you do have to pressure to get the water to go back into those formations.
And also another thing, so natural resources again. Why is it they aren't adapting systems like they have up in Montana or states up there, where some of the European companies would over here and drill here, they're using natural resources that they were up into. Some of those real drill sites have never had any diesel or anything all out there drilling. They're using it for drilling and doing everything, and then while they're clear, they're condensating the natural gas and hauling it to the next site. And so those are all self-supporting. There's no natural resource being wasted.
We now have carbon collectors on a lot of the wells that are here in South Texas, and they're reusing them.
On that same one, with respect to waste of the natural gas, here last year, October, August of last year, right here, 2 miles over here, well made, national news, 70-foot flare, two flares, it's my neighbor's, part of mine too. But 70-foot flare, look at all that fuel that went out and wasted. 70 feet natural gas.
And sometimes when that comes out at a higher pressure than we anticipate, we're not prepared to collect it without blowing out the machinery. And so flaring is the only way not to just let the gas into the air where it might cause damage to wildlife and to vegetation. So burning it neutralizes it on the spot.
Question for either person on the panel or all of you. My name is Sarah Kennedy, and I'm a JP here in Wilson County. I have a question about the education of the people, or what job skills do people need if they want to work directly in the oil field, and what is being done educationally, either in high schools or at the college level, or trade schools, or whatever it is. What are we doing as a state to prepare people to better serve in the oil and gas industry?
That's a good question. That's something that Senator Kennedy has a big focus on education. So that's always been one of the questions she had. She tells me I'm going to do, I think she was at sort of one of these forums and had more oil and gas industry folk. And, you know, she said, well, we want to get more these petroleum engineering degrees and these other kind of education to get the people who are running these companies and these sites. We want to homegrow them in this area. And the oil exec said, oh, don't worry about that. We'll get them from San Antonio and Houston. We'll just hire, we've got truck drivers and roustabouts that we need right here. And so our perspective is we do need to be developing education from high school into technical school, even into four-year universities for some degrees, to try to get that homegrown talent to continue to develop right here at home. There are some people that are doing it. I think Alamo College is starting to do some of these programs, and they have local units. The county, and that's the least of us, they have a mobile trailer that has a lot of the equipment for training, and they go around to the sites of high schools and they start training folks. So they're starting spawn. You know, not that we have a need for it, but it's a slow process. You have to kind of go from the ground up because this is sort of a new phenomenon. So
there's hardly a job in the oil industry, whether it is a trucking job or whether it is somebody who works on the rig, that doesn't need math skills. So the more you can encourage your schools to have really good math programs and get the kids interested in participating and continuing on, that way we will not only get the trucking jobs and the rig jobs, but they'll be prepared then to go to college and do the engineering jobs and the economics. Because guess what? Half of oil and gas is accounting. So it's something that people don't think about, but that's something that we really do need. And I think the more math we can get, and if we can get our legislators to help promote math and science in our schools, it would be very helpful.
chat and nothing else to keep on going. But as I was talking about earlier, when you talk about your middle term and future, you know, long term future needs and building sort of more sustainable communities out of it. When some of the jobs go away, even if it's a cyclical, just a dip, short term, or if it's more long term, you want the folks that are working out here to already have the skills that they need to translate into other job fields so that they're not left out of the lurch when activity dips.
My name is Joanne Yuhas, and I have a two-part question, and I'm feeding off a little bit of what Lynn asked. First of all, I'd like to know, is this fracking, is it inspected, and if so, how regularly? And also, and this would be more for the attorney up there, if there have been any issues with health from this, have there been any lawsuits ensued because of that? Thank you.
So the first part of the question, 9 out of 10 wells that are drilled onshore require fracking. If we don't frack, we don't produce, and it's going to really curtail the economy if we can't produce. So it is a major part of enhanced recovery of any well. Very few wells flow naturally for an extended period of time without some type of stimulation.
Speaking to the inspections, it's a factor of manpower. Railroad Commission particularly, and we have done a good job of improving that. 4 years ago, you know, 6 years ago, they were woefully underfunded, especially for the room that they were having. They were short on people, they were short on their information technology resources, and that over the last several years, the state has finally really took it seriously in funding it. So now we're starting to see the fruits of that we can get more out there. I know that we hear from constituents from time to time with issues. It's, maybe it's that well, it looks like it's flaring too long. We call the Railroad Commission, and they usually have information on gas. They told us they were starting on this date because they could only do the flaring temporarily. And so they say they've got 2 more days, we'll go out there a few days, make sure they shut down, no calls back, we went out there, they shut down. So I think that they're very responsive, but it is a case-by-case situation because the amount of activity is so vast, you can't have somebody in every place all the time. But I know they're doing their best, and if you ever see anything that you think was amiss, you just let us know. We can work with the Railroad Commission. I know the Railroad Commission has resources right on their webpage for you to contact them yourself, but we're more than happy to sort of be the go-between and facilitate that kind of information sharing and get action.
More questions? I do have one while I'm walking over there. The city of Denton decided to not allow fracking. Was there a reason for that?
Yeah, well, it's very far away from our district, so I'm not intimately aware, but I know that it was a citizen-driven petition. It wasn't the council, it was a group of individuals that got together and made a campaign and then started writing to go ahead and vote for it. You know, to hear some people tell it, it was because they got all the UNT students that they voted for, but that was an easy sell. I don't know really what happened. I know that it's very much unlike what we see here in the Indian Shale, as I alluded earlier, because in places like where the Barnett Shale is being developed, it's highly urban, it's very densely populated, and so there's this inherent tension and conflict between the activity and where people are living and working and playing. Out here, we have a little more space. We have a little more room. I mean, usually it's more welcome as the organized activity, so long as it's not socially responsible. In Denton, I think it's, like I said, there's more conflict because they live so close to it, it's all jammed in the same spot.
They're really not used to, in the urban areas, to have a well at the end of their block that diverts traffic and it causes noise because a rig runs 24/7. So that's one of the reasons they implemented the fences that go around there that help contain the noise and trying to get in and out as fast as possible and still be safe while you're drilling. And I think it's important that the companies be responsive to the urban areas when they are drilling there because you don't want an issue like that. But we also need to be responsive in the rural areas where we don't put an injection well 300 feet from somebody's back door, and the trucks are coming all day and night and dumping excess fluid down that injection well. You can hear that even if you're out in the boonies. So, and I live out in the boonies, and I have a well on my property, and I'm one of the probably the worst people they have to deal with, because I know what they can do right and what they can do wrong, and I think it's real important we stay on top of that. But the urban areas do have a bigger issue, as he alluded to. We don't really see that as much here.
That was a really good segue. Mine only has more of a comment. What you were saying earlier about the Railroad Commission's limited authority and jurisdiction, what y'all can and cannot do, you can't do anything about the roads and the traffic. You can't do anything about the noise or the odor and the air or the trash that is, you know, subsequent to that. And I know Judge Burdett and Judge Jackson and I have been through some different trainings on illegal dumping, as it refers to just regular Class C misdemeanor things, depending on what the volume of the dumping is. And that's something that normal everyday citizens can be aware of and know that they don't have to call the Railroad Commission because there's a bunch of trash on the well site. That is more of a local thing that you can call your local law enforcement on, and the smell and those kinds of things. And if, I don't see any city representatives here. Chief Bull just left. But our municipalities and our county law enforcement have a big impact on that. And that's something that citizens can see and make others aware of if you see things like that.
You should also report that to the operator if you see that, because none of us in the oil industry want bad players on our block. And it's very important that they clean up their sites and that they take care of the people that they're dealing with in those areas. So if you do see something like that, the Railroad Commission may not be able to do anything about it, and your local authorities may not want to go out there. But if you call that operator and complain, trust me, that would get cleaned up.
Maybe you walk all the way across.
I'm sorry, the second part of my question wasn't answered. And Krista, I'm going to direct it to you. To your knowledge, let's say within the past 20 to 30 years, have there ever been any law cases referencing ill health due to the fracking from the water? Or does anybody have that knowledge?
So, you know, obviously health is of primary importance to everyone. You know, there are studies, there was a study that came out today about corn and shale, in particular, that they did find some fracking chemicals in some of the water. I can say that I haven't.
Yes.
I
whenever you're injecting into a bed that has been empty before, the only reason we would have drilled there was because there's fractures all around there anyway, and that extra pressure potentially could be causing some tremors. But one of the facts that you need to be aware of is there's over 2,000 earthquakes in the United States every single day, and until 2013, anything under a 3 wasn't reported. So since 2013, we've seen a lot more activity because people are reporting that it's getting reported. It probably should have been reported before that, but the Earth's crust moves all the time, and anybody who lives in an area where there is no drilling, no injection wells, and no fracking also find that they have cracked foundations, they have issues with tremors, and they have earthquakes in their areas. So it's like she said, it's the jury's still out on that one. It could potentially be a issue because it's already in an area that the fractures exist. And those fractures are sitting there waiting to move at any minute anyway. So any kind of extra pressure could potentially cause a little bit of movement.
I'm sure everyone's heard about all the earthquakes in Oklahoma. And there are, I can't remember what the exact number is, but they can time it to when the fracking started taking off really big there. I mean, they have massive amounts of earthquakes. I mean, it's up something like 400% just since they started fracking. And I think that pretty much says that it's due to the fracking. So you don't just have to look at Texas. You guys can look at studies going on in other states. And I hope you're doing that seriously, because there are plenty of other states that have plenty of studies that show the damage that could be caused by this.
Well, we certainly we're going to look at everything we possibly can. And we'll work with our commission to make sure that they're doing that.
Anyone else? Going once?
I just want to thank our three speakers so very much for coming tonight, because this is what we all knew, what we needed to have done, and that was to educate us on this issue. And we appreciate your time and effort that you've made to come here. And I'd like everyone to give them a big hand.
Thank you. We do have one more question. Please help yourself before you go. And drive careful on the way home. See you next time.